This week on Fireside Chat, we're looking at the Flames and how they've done since the trade deadline with all the new call-ups they brought up. This is Fireside Chat, Episode 40, Quack Attack, recorded March 16th, 2014.
Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
It's a night after the Flames beat the Stars in a shootout, and we're just a couple hours before the Flames take on the Coyotes on the road. And it's Dan and Matt back talking Flames hockey with you. How you doing tonight, Matt?
Very excellent.
Yeah, what'd you think of that game last night?
Oh, it's good to see the Flames having a never-say-die attitude, and, you know, it's always good to see second efforts being rewarded.
Yeah, I was watching the game with a friend of mine, and when the Flames were down 3-1, we really thought, okay, you know, Dallas has got this one. And a lot of people started actually leaving the bar that we were at. And just seeing the team come back to tie that game, and then to have Corbin Knight, of all people, win in the shootout, it was a really nice, as we've seen since they've all come up since the deadline, it was a really nice display of the young talent in this organization.
Oh, very much so. It's good to see that they're putting efforts in even when the score is out of reach either way. So, you know, it's good coaching and good efforts by the kids.
For sure. And two guys that stood out for me last night, one of them was a guy that I never thought I'd see again in a Flames uniform, and that was Joey McDonald. I thought he didn't play necessarily the best game he could have played, but he played a pretty good game for a guy that we haven't seen at the NHL level for a while. And the other guy was Mike Camilleri.
Yeah, it's good to see Camilleri getting over his little slump that he's been on and hitting the net instead of missing just wide.
Yeah. Well, you know, you and I talked last week about the trade deadline and Camilleri, and how we said that we're okay that the Flames didn't trade him at the deadline, but that they have to re-sign him. And to me, you almost wish that he would have had this kind of play right before the deadline, because they might have got more value for him. But the fact he's playing this way now, do you think that he's trying to catch the eye of people come July 1st, or do you still think that he intends to sign here?
Anytime a player plays good, it's a good thing for the player. So, you know, I'm hoping that he decides to stay here, but, you know, it won't hurt him either way with his efforts thus far.
Since the trade deadline, since we talked last, we've seen a lot of kids come up on this team, and I think we've seen some of the best efforts from the Calgary Flames that we have all season. If you look at this stretch of games, it looks like everybody's energized, everybody's wanting to play, everybody's trying to fight for a spot here. And one thing that you noted was that Joel Colborne has looked really good lately.
Yeah, he's definitely starting to use his body more effectively and go to the places that he needs to as an NHL player to be successful. You know, because having a 6'5" player that it plays a very passive game, like, that player's not going to stick in the NHL for very long. So him adapting and changing how he's approaching the game will help him both secure an NHL job down the road and, you know, improve the chances of him getting a good contract moving forward.
I think that Colborne's been one of these bubble guys all year who has kind of been right on the edge of, you know, is he going to stay at the NHL level? Is he got a future in this league? And we know that he came in because of Brian Burke. He was brought in by Burke in Toronto. Burke liked him there. Burke brought him in here. And I think he is starting to show that he has what it takes to compete at the NHL level, don't you?
Yeah, and realistically, anybody that's 6'5 is going to get every opportunity to try and figure out their game. And if you look at his early season performance, you know, if he was 6'1", I don't think he would have been in the NHL. But, you know, with him now, he's starting to put all the pieces together. And he and the Flames are reaping the rewards from that.
And that's what you want to see in a rebuilding team. I mean, you want to see us give guys a chance who perhaps haven't had a chance before. And, you know, we're fortunate this seems to be working out with Joe. So we'll probably keep him on long term. I believe he's a restricted free agent at the end of this year, but that he should be fairly easy to qualify. But yeah, I'd like to see him stick around. I think we've given him a chance. He's excelled. There's no point in cutting him loose now. Let him, you know, come back next year and play again.
Yeah, exactly. And this is the type of thing that rebuilding teams should do, is find reclamation projects, whether it's guys like Chris Russell or Colborne or even Gagliardi, and give them an actual chance to figure out at the NHL level their game. And, you know, if they do figure it out, then you've got a very good asset for nothing. And if not, yeah, well, you lost a fifth-round pick. Like, woo.
Yeah, exactly. And a fifth-round pick is fairly easy to reclaim as well.
Yeah, exactly.
I think if you look at those three names that you mentioned, I mean, Chris Russell, you and I talked about him after they re-signed him. He's excelled on this team this year. He's done better than I think anyone thought he would. I think that definitely the pro scout who found him and suggested that we sign him, that was a good pickup. That was a good reclamation project. I think Joe Colborne, another really good reclamation project. I'm still on the fence about TJ Gagliardi. He hasn't come along as much as I hoped he would this year.
I know. He's looking a little Blake Como-ish, but, you know.
He's in the final season of a deal, too, isn't he?
Yeah, I think so. It's one of those things that with players like that, you just, if they don't work out for you, you move them out and you get the next group of players in. Yeah. So.
And yeah, I think, you know, of those three, two out of three is a good number.
Yeah. Well, even if you got one out of three working for you, like, that's a win.
But
so
the fact we got two, of those three is showing that we're doing something right in this rebuild.
Exactly.
You know, even looking down the roster at guys like Paul Byron, who when we got him in a trade with Buffalo, didn't look like he was going to do all that much. He's looking good right now. So I think there's a lot of guys who just needed a chance.
Yeah. Well, one thing that Flames fans need to be patient with is usually young players, it takes till they're 23, 24, unless they've got star potential like Monahan, to figure things out. Like, if you look at Backlund, per se, like, he was, when he was 22, he wasn't doing very good and was kind of like a bubble NHL player. But, you know, now you flash forward to this year and he's figured things out and is looking like a really good NHL player. So, you know, just be patient. If, you know, guys like Berchi or Gaudreau kind of hit a wall temporarily.
And, you know, I think that's a good point. A lot of people paint every draft pick with the same brush. They'd paint a high, you know, top 15 first-round pick. Not all these guys are ready to jump to the NHL right away. That's why they're drafted lower. They have issues with their game. They're not ready. And even a guy like Berchi, who has been demoted to the AHL, that doesn't mean that he's been banished by the team or exiled by the team. It just means they're sending him to a level where they think he can excel. But, you know, if they didn't think he was going to go anywhere, they'd try to get rid of him, and they haven't yet. So I think that Berchi's definitely got a future here.
Yeah. Well, like, the example I have referred to a few times is Nazem Kadri and how many times he was sent to the AHL and bounced around before, you know, figuring things out at the NHL level and becoming the player that he was expected to be.
Yeah, for sure. Well, and if you look even before the current regime was here, the Flames have done a very good job at this over the last, let's say, 8 years of taking guys who were sort of reclamation projects and really making them into something. I mean, you know, we took Mika Kiprusoff, who's a third-string goaltender, made him into something. We took, you know, I'd even go as far back as Curtis Glencross, who was a nobody when we got him and really made him into something. Christian Eselius was very similar back in the day. So the Flames have been very good at this over the last, you know, handful, maybe 8-9 years.
Yeah, well, like, even look at Conroy. He was just the third-line center with St. Louis, and, you know, Iginla turned him into a 70-point player, so.
Yeah. So, yeah, and it's, you know, I know it might be frustrating for fans, but this is the good thing about a rebuild, is that we get the chance to experiment with a lot of different players, see who works and see who doesn't. I don't know if it's the young kids coming up from the farm system with Troy Ward's, you know, winning attitude, or you know, coming from a successful team, or what it is, but you noted it, and I think you're right. The team's definitely had a different attitude, it seems, on the ice when they've been up by several goals and when they've been down by several goals.
Yeah, like, the one thing, like, when the Flames got up 4-0 against the Ducks the other day, and going into the intermission, I was wondering how they would respond to that, because that's a different kind of adversity for them that they've never faced. And especially a team like Anaheim, like, they could easily come back from 4 goals. They're that good of a team. So, you know, how they responded, you know, kind of says a lot of how they are as players. And, you know, they kept the foot on them until the game was over. And in the past few years, we've kind of seen the Flames not have that killer attitude. And, you know, like, they would give up goals like that and, you know, make it a lot more interesting of a game than, you know, what the Flames did the other
day. Yeah, I was watching that Ducks game, and I'm sitting there watching the Flames get up and going, okay, when are the Ducks going to come back? Like, I was not expecting the Flames to spank the Ducks as bad as they did. And I'm just sitting there waiting for the Ducks to come back and to kind of say, okay, kids, you've had your fun. You know, let the real pros take over here.
Yeah, it's good coaching by the Flames as well to instill that kind of attitude of don't care about the score, just keep going. Because, like, if you look at the second and third period against the Ducks, the Flames still, like, if you take the first period out, the Flames still won 3-2. So, you know, like, that's a very encouraging thing that, like, they're not treating the score as, like, the be-all and end-all. You know, they're just treating how they're playing the game as the most important part.
I think that a lot of it's mental conditioning. It's that these players have been, you know, trained well at the AHL level of what it means to win a hockey game and what it takes mentally to win a hockey game. And they're coming from a winning team where, you know, they are used to being ahead and they know how to hold on to leads. And I mean, I'm not a psychologist, I'm not a hockey coach, but I think that that's really helped this team to stay with it and to, you know, when they're on top, to know how to play with a lead.
Well, it definitely is encouraging either way. Like, you know, I'd rather see them draft a little lower and play like this than go full Edmonton and, you know, have the same problems that the Oilers are having, you know, at both ends of the ice. So, you know, there's not really much of anything that I can complain about.
I think if you're going to call up as many young players the Flames have, you almost want them to play this way. I mean, if you're bringing these guys up from a winning team in the AHL just to stink up the ice at the NHL level, is it really worth doing? To me, if you're bringing these guys up, you want them to be winning here. You want them to be, you know, you want their time in the NHL to be worth it, I guess, and showing them how to win at this level and what that means.
Yeah.
And even, you know, you're talking about how they were getting up against the Ducks, but even if you look at the Dallas game, how they played when they were down. I mean, they, you know, they were down 3-1 against Dallas at one point. And just to see that effort that they kept putting in and the fact that they weren't playing like they were down by two. They were playing like it was a tie game.
Yeah, well, it's the same as that Islanders game from last week where they were down 3-1 after two. And they just never said die. And, you know, they ended up getting 2 points each game. So, you know, it's good to see. At any point in time when the kids come up and play and are showing as well as the current Flames are, you know, that's encouraging for next year and for beyond. Sure.
And it's given us a good look at those kids. And taking a look at the kids that they brought up, is there anyone that's really impressing you or anyone that's disappointing you of that group?
I can't really say I'm overly disappointed by anybody. I'm encouraged by Knight's face-off percentage and, you know, Ordeo, how he's playing. Yeah, I can't really complain. They all look like NHL players. So, you know, nobody that's looking like a fish out of water.
To me, I think
anyway.
That some of these guys still have some holes in their game before they'll be full-timers. I'm seeing Ben Hanowski playing, and his skating still looks weak to me. It doesn't look like where it needs to be. We noticed that last year when he got pulled up too, but he's looking like his skating's just not where it needs to be a full-time NHLer.
It's one of those things that, especially with the Flames' depth at forward, that, if you're not going to stick right away, you're likely going to get passed, especially with guys like Gaudreau and Poirier coming up shortly. So, if they continue, they could likely carve out NHL careers, even if it isn't with us. It's just, you'd like to see them rise to the occasion anyway.
I think everyone else has looked pretty good, though. I've been surprised by Corbin Knight. He was a guy who, when he got acquired here, I really thought he was going to make the jump to the NHL right away. And seeing him in the AHL all year, every time they needed a call-up, I kind of thought, Corbin's going to come up. And the fact that he didn't led me to believe there was something there that I wasn't seeing, some flaw in his game or something. But now that he's been brought up, to me, he looks like he belongs at this level.
Yeah. And both offensively and defensively, there's been times where he's looked a little out of place, especially in one of the goals that we gave up in the Vancouver game. But, on the whole, he looks like a rookie, but someone that will be a player.
Yeah, he's a rookie with some potential. I mean, of course he's going to look like he's, green. He is green. But he looks like a guy that they can change and mold and work with.
Oh, yeah. I could easily see him becoming like a Jared Stoll type, good third line center down the road. So,
Yeah. It does.
It just takes time.
And I think the nice thing is that we have the time. We're not trying to rush these guys in because we want to make a playoff push or anything. We have the time it's going to take to develop these guys.
Yeah, exactly. Like, we got 2 or 3 years still before we're realistically going to be competing in a playoff spot. So, just got to be patient.
And, I was surprised last night in the Dallas game to see Joey McDonald in a Flames jersey again. He started the year here as the backup. He kind of got sent down to the AHL when Barra got pulled up. I never really thought that we'd see McDonald in a Flames jersey again, but he didn't play too bad in that game.
Yeah. I can't complain, and that's kind of what he's there for, is to be like the insurance backup. And he never plays like extremely poorly. He's just a slightly below average backup, and he does his job well, and you can throw him out there and he'll give you a reasonably good chance to win.
And yeah, Ordeo was looking tired, and somebody needed to spell him off, and I think he did exactly that, as he gave Ordeo a night to sit down, and we still got the win. So, to me, he did his job.
Yeah, exactly. And, like, in that Ducks game, Ordeo was starting to look a little messy in his approach, and, a couple of the each of the goals that Anaheim scored was kind of wishy-washy on his part. So, any young goalie needs a break every once in a while. So,
yeah, I think every goalie, except if your last name is, say, Kiprusoff or Brodeur, needs a break once in a while. I mean, those guys are your Iron Man goalies. Everybody else needs to sit down and rest once in a while.
Yeah, exactly.
Do we know when Ramo is expected to be back?
I believe he should be back next week, give or take. Hartley, a couple days ago, said that if he was a skater, he'd likely be in already. But because he's a goalie and moving up and down and all that, he's still a little slow on that. So,
okay. Yeah,
said about a week or two. So, probably towards like the Nashville game next week or something.
So when he does come back, if you were the coach, would you keep a goalie pairing here of Ramo Ordeo, or would you keep the goalie pairing of Ramo McDonald?
Very much a Finnish netminder duo.
And do you think that Ordeo stays as the starter from here on in, or do you go 1A, 1B?
I would give each half the games, just because that way you can see what you have, like, as an addition for next year. Because each of those goalies is going to be here next year. barring a weird trade with Colorado or something. So
we've got a couple years on both their deals. I think Ordeo might be an RFA this year, but he'll be easy to qualify. So yeah, they'll both be here. And I think that even McDonald going down to the AHL, they're hurting for talent right now on the Heat. So send him down, you know, give them a veteran goalie going forward.
Yeah. Like, you might even see Romo go down just for a conditioning stint.
That's true. Yeah.
Possibly for a game or two, so...
Well, how long can they be down on a conditioning stint? It's a two-week thing, isn't it?
I have no clue. I think most of the times you get two games in, give or take, and then you're back up. Okay,
so yeah, there's lots of flexibility the Flames have there.
Yeah.
I think a lot of the success the team's having, both on the ice with actual, you know, games played and the hockey they're playing, but also in player development, has been attributed to the coaching staff. And you and I have talked in the past about how much we're liking this coaching staff. Some of them, like Jelena, are rookies at this whole thing, but I really think that Jay Feaster, because he really put the staff together, did a good job of putting together a coaching staff for the rebuild.
Yeah, and you can't knock any one of the coaches at either level. Like, everybody's doing a great job with how these players are playing. Like, if you look at other teams, like, realistically, the Flames have either the worst or second worst team on paper of any of them. So, like, the fact that we're in fifth last and, you know, doing a lot better than several of the other teams that are around us, that's very much a testament to the good coaching that we've been getting. Yeah,
for sure. And I think one thing that we're seeing, at least I'm seeing, is more player development this year. It seems like the players are developing throughout the season. We're seeing guys, you know, and we can see their games physically developing through the year as we watch these players. So I think that that's probably a lot to do with Bob Hartley, Jacques Cloutier, Martin Jelena, and Clint Malarchuk, who are here and working with these guys, I think, on a different level than Sutter was.
Well, one of the things that I've noticed with Hartley is that he lets the players play within themselves instead of conforming to a system. And, like, that was one of the knocks on Brent Sutter, especially when it came with players like Bomeister, is that, you know, they had a certain style of game and it didn't comport with Sutter's mode and they struggled badly. But now that Hartley's the coach, you know, like we saw last year, Bomeister played exceptionally well and we ended up getting a first plus for him. So, you know.
No, I think Hartley's doing what you need to do as a coach. You need to build your system around the pieces you have, not say, this is the system, figure out how to play within it. And maybe that's why Hartley's got a Stanley Cup ring and Sutter doesn't.
Yeah. And that's the exact right type of coach that a rebuilding team needs.
Yeah, you know, you might not be able to have the game plan you want because you're working with a, you know, you're not playing with a full deck, if you will. You don't have the best players on the ice. But I think that, yeah, he's come up with a strategy that works. I mean, they're winning games. They're, you know, especially lately, they've been winning games by quite a bit. And so he's doing a good job with the pieces that he's got.
It's just one of those things that, you know, like, if you look at the Flames roster, we basically have one second line and, like, two third lines and a fourth line. So, you know, you can't, like, throw out your star players because you don't have any right now. So, you know, he's definitely doing the best of what he's got to work with.
I think one thing I've seen with him, and we've talked about this earlier in the season as well, he seems to be focusing more on the off-ice development too, especially earlier in the year. This team was going places like the Firefighters Training Center and doing some work there. He seems like he's focusing a lot more off the ice on building this team than Sutter did.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, you need to have the players buy in to help each other, not just be random people wearing Flames jerseys like several years of the past few years have been.
That's a good way to put it. And they got the fire helmet after the games again, too. And if you remember last time they did that, they had that green hard hat. So there's a lot more, I think, you know, focus being put into dressing room morale and how these guys are interacting with each other off the ice.
And that's always a good thing as a motivational tool. So, like, really, it's one of those things where for where we are in the rebuild, there's nothing
no,
to
there's
complain
not.
About.
And I think that having a coach like Bob Hartley, who wasn't in the NHL for a couple of years, might have even helped him as a coach, because he's coaching a different level of player when he was over in Switzerland. I mean, it's not an NHL level player, and I imagine there's more work that has to be done at that level to get these guys playing where he wants them. So that probably helped him as a coach.
Yeah, well, like, his last coaching thing was in Atlanta, and like, they were a quasi playoff team then as well, so, you know, like, this is a bit of a new experience for him as well, being in, like, complete rebuild mode, not, you know, semi-competitive.
Yeah, if you look, though, when he was in Colorado, he did have a fairly young roster, if you look back at the roster that he won the Cup with, so he knows how to motivate young players.
You know, like, usually when a team goes into a rebuild, you're hoping that, like, most of it goes right, and, like, the players adapt to the NHL fairly easily and all that, but, you know, like, this has probably been one of the best starts to a rebuild that I've seen any team in any sport, really, and, like, that's, you know, like, I'm very nitpicky when it comes to mistakes or, you know, anything that might be a problem, and, like, I'm having a hard time finding any, and, you know, like, that's amazing to me. So,
and, you know, I think what might have helped that, I mean, you know, just looking back on it, if you look at the people who were making those decisions, it was Jay Feaster at a Stanley Cup ring, it was Bob Hartley at a Stanley Cup ring. These guys know what success is. They know what they have to get to have success. So I think it's easier to build a roadmap to get there when you know what you need at the end.
Exactly. You know, it just takes a lot of little steps to go from being a rebuilding team to a contender. And, you know, the first few steps in this journey have gone in the right way.
And I think that even, to me, it's almost sum up this journey with the Ducks game last week. I think the Ducks game just showed the hard work and the effort that this team's put in all year, and the fact that they can play against a contending team.
Well, like, the other day, like, they made Anaheim look like an AHL team. That's how overpowering they were. So, like, I've never seen them do that to the Ducks at any point. Usually that's what happens to us by them.
No, very true, very true. And they have the Ducks actually again this month, so we'll see if they can spank them again.
Yeah.
If you remember, Bob Hartley said, I think it was right before the trade deadline, that he wants to approach the rest of the season in 7-game series. He wants to approach them like a playoff series. And if you look at their games since the deadline, they won against the Islanders, they lost to the Canucks, they lost to the Kings, they won to the Ducks, they won to Dallas. So if they win tonight's game against the Coyotes, they've won this 7-game series.
Yeah. And, you know, like, that type of preparation helps for once the team is better, because you do get in that mindset of trying to win and overcome the adversities that creep up randomly. And all that. So it's good.
If you look at that 7-game series mentality, the next 7-game series will be against Buffalo, the Predators, the Oilers, the Sharks, the Ducks, and the Rangers. Do you think that they can win 4 of 7 in that series as well?
Honestly, with how they're playing, they could easily win 4 out of any series at the moment. So, you know, hard work will definitely outclass anything.
I think this next 7 games is going to be a real test for this team. You know, you've got the Sharks coming, you got the Ducks coming back, you got the Rangers coming. Those are going to be 3 tough teams to beat. And if they can do it, then yeah, you're right. The hard work's paying off. But I think this will be a real test of these kids and how well they're going to be bounced back if they lose one of those games or if they really get pressure put on them.
Yeah. Oh, it's good that they'll be getting an education soon.
For sure. And those are the teams to do it. You know, if we're going to bring these guys up at the NHL level, why not put them against top-line NHL teams?
Well, they need to know how to beat them. So, you know, you only get to learn that by actually beating them.
And speaking of kids, a little bit of a prospect note. Johnny Gaudreau today has extended his point streak to 31 games, at least 1 point in the last 31 games, which ties Paul Kariya's record in Hockey East. That's quite an impressive streak. I know a lot of people look down at the Hockey East as, you know, the competitiveness of that league, but in any league, a 31-game point streak is amazing.
Yeah, and it's one of those things that if Gaudreau was 6 feet tall, he would already be a star in the NHL. It's just that the only thing that can hold him back is that he's only 5'6". And, you know, he's just that good offensively. You know, I honestly don't see that being a problem the long term for his NHL career. Because, like, you look at guys like Paul Byron and Nathan Gerby, it did take them a while to figure things out, but, like, each of them is performing at the NHL level. So, I could easily see Gaudreau being a 50-60 point guy. It just might take him a little while to adapt.
I think there's, when you have a guy who's 5'6", 5'8", pretty much anything less than 6 foot, I think there's a lot of skepticism that comes built in with that. And I think that right now, Johnny Gaudreau, Johnny Hockey as they call him, is really having to beat all that skepticism. And he's trying to at least say to people, look, I've proven I can play this game. You have to at least give me a look at the NHL level.
Yeah, and with how he sees the game and all that, I don't see it being, like, it's not like he's a banger, you know. So, his job is to, like, feed the puck through people's sticks to find the open guy and all that. So, you know, and he's shown to be extremely adept at doing things like that. So I don't see there being any really real limitations other than he might take a while to physically adapt to the NHL.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I'm also looking at a Brian Burke-style team, which I think even with the new GM will still have. A Brian Burke-style team is a bunch of big boys playing on it. So I think even if he's on a line with two other large guys around him, you know, he'll definitely be able to kind of move quickly and pass the puck around to those guys, but he'll also have a little bit of bouncers, if you will, guys to keep him safe.
Yeah. Well, like, if you look at around the league, like, you know, good teams do have smaller players on them. Like, you know, like, if you look at, like, Patrick Kane, he's not going to intimidate anyone with his physicality.
No, he's not. But he intimidates every goaltender and every defenseman he goes against because he can score the goals.
Yeah, and, like, that's the thing. Like, if you have, like, the rest of your team being bigger physically, you know, you can get away with guys that are that small, like Gaudreau or Camilleri. So, you know, I'm not really concerned about the height. Like, it's not as much of a detriment as it was back in the 90s and that, where it was basically just Theo Fleury.
Well, I was going to say, if nothing else, the Flames, I think, arguably have the best little player to ever play in the NHL, the best sub-6-footer, which was Theo Fleury. So fans here know what to expect from a little guy like that. Flames, you know, history shows us that it can work.
Yeah, it just, the player needs to adapt to the situation, so, you know, and he'll be given every opportunity. You know, someone with that level of skill, like, he could be a star player even though he's 5'6". So, you know, you gotta let him do his thing and let him determine where he is.
And even if he doesn't turn out to be a, you know, top flight NHLer, I think he will have a spot in pro hockey for a long time, whether it's in the AHL level, the NHL level, kind of a call-up going between the two. You know, I think he's definitely shown that he can play the game of hockey at a high level.
Oh, definitely.
The other prospect note that we have here is that the Flames have offered Brett Kulak a contract. This is a guy that's been with the organization for some time now. I have to look up when he actually got drafted.
I think in 2011 or 2012. Yeah,
so he's been here like for that. A few years. He's one of those names that I've, you know, we've seen around at training camp stuff for a couple of years.
Yeah, 2012. Okay.
So he's been here for a couple of years. He's playing for the Vancouver Giants right now. He's always had, last year he had a pretty good year. I think he got 59 points with the Giants. As a defenseman, which is amazing.
Yeah. Well, Kulak, he is a similar-ish type of defenseman as a prospect that TJ Brody was, in that he is very much an offense-first guy, but he has taken several strides defensively where he's not looking that bad as a defenseman. You know, and he does have probably the best slap shot of any of our defensive prospects. So, you know, like, if you can round out the defensive aspect of his game, you know, you could have a top four guy. Sort of like a Chris Russell, but, you know, maybe better defensively. So, you know. I don't mind that they offered him that contract, and I hope they get Ryan Culkin signed shortly,
too. Yeah, Kulak and Culkin are both guys I'd like to see in the Flames organization at least get a crack. Give them to the AHL coaches and let them work their magic there and see what we got.
Yeah. Like, when TJ Brody first got drafted, I don't think anybody saw him even turning into an NHL defenseman at all, let alone how good he's emerged into. So, you know, you can't discount random chance, you know, when you have somebody that has that kind of offensive skill, you know, you have to give them every opportunity to figure out the defense end.
I think, you know, it's funny you mentioned TJ Brody, because I'm just thinking back to that, and I think even management didn't expect him to stick around, because they gave him the training camp number 66, and they wouldn't take him off, they wouldn't take it off him for a while, so I think if they were plan to keep him around, they would have given him a real number.
And, you know, like, at times back when Brody first got his contract, like, he looked lost in his own end entirely, and it's like, wow, you're bad defensively.
You're a defenseman, that should be where you excel.
Yeah, like, you know, why don't you go and be a forward, and you might get an NHL career out of it, because you're not half bad.
Yeah, exactly, go play wing.
Yeah, exactly. But, you know, he's taken a huge few steps forward and is looking like a top-pairing defenseman now. So, you know, that's the thing with defensemen. They are so hard to predict. Like, they're almost like goalies. Like, if they have some higher-end talent, then, you know, you have to give them as much opportunity to figure out the rough edges. Because, you know, you never know where that top guy is going to come from. Like, if you look at our top pairing, well, even beyond that, like, you got Russell, who was a third-round pick. You got Weidman, who was an unsigned free agent. You got Giordano, who was an unsigned free agent. And Brody was a fourth-round pick. So, you know, you don't know what you're going to get. So, having someone that has that higher-end talent.
Yeah, Kulak's always seemed like the kind of guy to me who in a lot of organizations would get lost, especially a lot of organizations with deep blue-line prospects. But I think he's got an advantage there, because even though we have blue-line prospects coming up, he's still going to be in a position where I think they will give him a shot at the AHL level and give him a good look.
Yeah. Well, realistically, the Flames only have Sealoff, Wotherspoon, and a couple other guys that are marginal on the back end. It's not like we're Buffalo where we've got like 10 or 12 really good prospects back there. So
no, but at the same time, you've only got room for 6 of them, maybe 7 every year.
So you move out guys that are underperforming like Kundari or Breen or whomever and throw, you know, like even Ramage to an extent has been disappointing this year, so you move on. And, you know, let the next batch come in and, you know, just keep repeating that cycle.
And, you know, even if they're disappointing for 1 year, I don't want to discount them, but keep them around the organization. But, yeah, look at giving the guys who are consistent performers the call-ups.
Yeah, like Wotherspoon or what Sealoff would have got if he hadn't had that medical issue.
I think if the Flames can call up one young forward and one young defenseman every season, that's going to help keep that cycle going on.
Yeah. Well, I think we'll be ushering a few more forwards in the next year or two. We've got too many good ones coming up, like Poirier, Gaudreau, whoever we take in the first round this year, and so on. So,
yeah. I still wonder how many of those guys are going to end up wearing a Flaming C and how many we're going to move for assets, draft picks, etc. But, yeah, I think either way, there's definitely some good pieces coming up through the system. Well, Matt, anything else you want to talk about, or should we call it a night?
That's it for me. I just want to make one statement, though.
Sure.
And that's in regards to Matt Stajan and his wife. You know, everybody that I've encountered on Calgary Puck HF boards in my life, like, everybody is just devastated at what happened. And, you know, everybody supports you. And, you know, it's just such a crappy situation, and, you know, words can't describe how terrible something like that is. So, you know, just that everybody is behind you, and, you know.
Matt and Katie Stajan will be in the hearts and minds of Flames fans and NHL fans everywhere. I can't even start to imagine how difficult this must be for them to deal with and go through. But I know that the Stajans have the support of the Flames team. I've read about the wives and the girlfriends really taking care of them and going out of their way to support them, which is awesome to see. And I hope that Matt Stajan takes the time that he needs to get closure on this issue. I think that about wraps up the show for this week. Next week we're going to be starting a series where, on top of regular Flames news, we're going to be looking at Flames prospects in the system, the young players that are going to be coming up through this system in the next couple of years who we can expect to see in the rebuild. And next week we'll start with defensemen. We'll be talking about the young Flames defenseman in the system, and we also have a really special interview from former Flames captain and defenseman Todd Simpson. So tune back in for that. As usual, you can find us online on Twitter, we're at Fireside Podcast, on Facebook, we're facebook.com/firesidechat. You can find us on our website, firesidechat.ca, where you can subscribe for all the newest shows via RSS or email, and we hope to see everybody next week. Fireside Chat is produced and edited by Dan Stevenson. This show is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license information, visit firesidechat.ca.